Noragami is a series really near and dear to me. There's just so much I can say about it from all kinds of angles.
Sure, there's lots of really intriguing stuff going on. The whole world of the gods is super interesting, and the characters are all so much fun.
But for now, there's something I really want to focus on, and that's how masterfully Noragami portrays tragedy.
I'm Rila.
I'm Riley.
And you're watching Bulletoon!
So, first off, I just want to make this abundantly clear. Unless we specifically say otherwise, on our show, you can just assume we're talking strictly about the anime.
Right! Between manga, light novels, games, and whatever else, getting into the source material of every anime would be super complicated, totally inconvenient.
Especially when we talk about stuff from Bones. In case you hadn't noticed, creative liberties are, kind of their thing. Although the ones in Noragami are actually pretty reasonable.
They are! Oh, I'd love to talk about that another time. It's really interesting.
Sure. Anyway, like I said, Noragami is a really great series. It does a lot of things really well. But one thing I've always appreciated is how well it handles the more serious subjects it tackles.
A little while ago, we talked about Kaguya-sama and what makes its humor land so well. Sure, it's hilarious, but it also knows when to pull back and take itself seriously.
Well, the same principle also applies in the reverse. Noragami, by its very nature, tackles a lot of really heavy, dark subjects. There's a lot of tragedy inherent in it, so it helps that it doesn't lean into it too much.
It's like we said, comedy and tragedy enhance one another. So of course it works both ways.
Now, let's be clear, Noragami is funny, but there's a difference between a series being funny and being a comedy. Although by the same token, it's also not a tragedy, not by genre. That comes with its own set of rules and expectations.
Uh-huh. Something like Devilman Crybaby is a tragedy. Sort of. Noragami just uses tragedy and comedy as storytelling devices.
The story is covered in tragic beats, and it's not like there are any characters completely without them. Yukine, Bishamon, Kazuma, and, of course, Yato. Hell, the only character in the anime who doesn't really have any pre-existing tragedy in her life is Hiyori.
But that makes total sense! She's the only mortal involved in any of this, right? So she's on the outside, looking in, just like the viewer.
And she's even more at the forefront of things in the manga, making that point even clearer. But that's a tangent for another time. Point is, this series is loaded with tragedy. And part of what makes it click is that despite it being about gods, the characters are all extremely human.
What? But that would mean the concept of humanity is bigger than just the concept of mortality.
Well, it is when you think about it. At least that's the argument the series seems to be making. And it makes sense. It's really the best way to make an audience care about all of this. These gods have flaws. They have worries. They get emotional and have to make decisions that affect themselves and others.
The Shinki are basically spirits whose lives were cut short. They're basically living embodiments of tragedy. And the gods own the responsibility of knowing what causes that tragedy while keeping it from the Shinki themselves. They also have to bear whatever emotions their Shinki are going through. Now that we lay all this out, a god's existence in this world is actually pretty sad.
But Riley, if they die any other way, they just reincarnate! Yeah? And if this show were operating by the same rainbow unicorn gumdrop logic as 90% of all isekai or any romance that thinks a reincarnation ending is actually sweet and not massively infuriating, that'd matter! But it doesn't!
Can you tell Riley doesn't like that trope? Anyway, season 2 makes it really clear. Reincarnation is not a happy thing in this series. You died. Who you were is dead. And they aren't coming back. The new god that takes your place has none of your memories, none of your experience, nothing. It is a new person.
Frankly, it's kind of refreshing to have a series that actually makes that acknowledgement. Sure, the gods and spirits of the world put on this act to make it seem like it's this great thing, but just look at the way Yato talks to Ebisu after he reincarnates at the end of the arc. It's really somber and kind of heartbreaking. After all they went through to save him, they couldn't. And making reincarnation something other than just a reset button is a big factor in that.
Then we could easily talk about all the antagonists. In the storytelling sense, A tragedy is basically a story where the main character suffers consequences of refusing to change and evolve. They may pursue what they want, or just choose not to do anything, without acknowledging what it is they need. They either learn nothing in the end, or they learn entirely the wrong thing.
They're stories where the main character's stagnation leads to preventable consequences. It's true to life in a lot of ways, though obviously real-life tragedies are more nuanced than that. Still, as a storytelling device, it's really handy as, and I'm sure this goes without saying, tragic characters often make for some of the best antagonists.
The first season has Rabo, also Nora, kinda. But the point is Rabo. He's a really simple character that just takes the anxiety of the god's existence and compresses it all into one character.
He doesn't have any real followers. His way of life isn't sustainable for him anymore. And unlike Yato, he's stuck in the past. He doesn't know how to change. He wants Yato to kill him so he can die to someone who knew him.
It makes him a super strong foil to Yato. But that isn't all. Even the other antagonists face this kind of thing. And because of the world they took the time to build, it's all really strongly written.
Ebisu is basically the opposite. He's a prominent god that no one will be forgetting anytime soon. But it led to a tragic, almost fatalistic lack of regard for his own well-being. It was a pretty excellent way to basically flip the whole thing around, showing the opposite extreme. Sure, Yato convinces him to start valuing his life because of the reincarnation distinction we made earlier, but the tragedy is basically that he learned that lesson too late.
But he isn't really an antagonist, so he doesn't completely count. Izanami also isn't one either. She's more of an obstacle, a roadblock. But even she's a pretty tragic character. She can't die at all, but she's also basically trapped in Yomi. Alone. Forever. Is it any wonder that kind of isolation drove her insane?
Of course, the most obvious example is Bishamon. She's not a main antagonist, but still, she does hold a grudge towards Yato for the entire first season and half of the second one. She can't bring herself to move on, but as you learn about what happened, you do kind of get it. Bishamon is a kind goddess who treasures her Shinki like family, but because of that kindness, she has a lot of them, and that means she's not able to effectively tend to all of them equally. It's a problem that's exacerbated by the original event that started the whole feud with Yato. She learned the wrong lesson.
Because of what happened with them in the past, she started trying to distance herself from her Shinki so they wouldn't worry about her and get hurt again. But that didn't exactly work out the way she wanted.
Hell, it made things worse! As much as her grudge against Yato is tragic, the bigger tragedy is that all this happened again because she took the wrong lesson for the first time.
Well, that and because Kuguha is just the worst.
Oh yeah, screw that guy! Screw that guy in particular!
But now that we've laid all that out, let's get back to the lighter side of things. Like we said, Noragami is actually really funny when it wants to be. Some of that humor is dark, some of it's really crass and immature.
Some, she says.
That second part was usually Riley's favorite. She's so easily amused.
What, excuse you?
But humor is humor, and a lot of it was actually really well thought out. Some of the character quirks are even things that come from the more tragic aspects of their character, like Yato.
True. The reason Yato is such a friggin' narcissist and comically over-the-top attention whore is because he's afraid of being ignored or forgotten. And like we mentioned, gods in this universe die if people don't remember them. So as funny as Yato's antics are, there's a really tragic root to them.
In a 1957 issue of Cosmopolitan, TV personality Steve Allen was quoted as saying that comedy equals tragedy plus time. To paraphrase, anyway.
It's a pretty apt description of that relationship, right?
How fitting, then, that gods literally have all the time in the world.
Obviously, we have the phrase too soon for a reason. And, of course, there are things that simply aren't funny and never will be.
But many people laugh to hide their pain, and a series like this that lasts while acknowledging that pain is always a breath of fresh air.
Frankly, we haven't even scratched the surface here. It's gonna become a meme at some point, just you watch.
But this series is a really fun one to talk about, and those are our summarized thoughts on the whole thing.
So, what about you guys? You fans of Noragami? Holding out for a third season like the rest of us? Drop a comment below and give that like button a zap while you're down there.
Don't forget to subscribe, ring the bell, and check our links in the description.
This has been Bullet Zoom.
I'm Rila, signing off.
I'm Riley, bowing out.
Thanks for watching.
Keep up the awesome, and
stay tuned.